everybody. How you doing? It's Cinnamon Cooney, your art Sherpa, and today we're live and we're also doing something really special. It's CRAFTmas. Lindsay the Frugal Crafter put together an amazing multi-week collaboration event. If YouTube is working, that playlist is in the iCard, and also in the iCard is her fabulous ballerina dancer that she did in Pastels Live earlier today, where we all just hung out and chatted and do all that, like what we do on Live Art YouTube, because it's what we do, is hang out with each other and chat. Going on the mic is my husband, John. He is my co-captain. He makes sure that you get to see what I'm doing. He follows me around with a whack of cameras.
We have a few cameras.
We have a few. I'm sporting a custom special collab hat.
Oh, come up and spin around and see your collab hat.
Collab hat's a little bit cray cray.
It's got, what, you have castles on your hat?
I do. And today, in very short order, we're going to be painting this fabulous painting right here. And I'm going to be ambushing John right now. Lindsay was a sweetheart, and she gave away a painting on her channel today.
How nice of her.
It was. And so guess what I'm going to do?
What are you going to do?
I'm going to give away the study.
You're going to give away our painting.
I'm going to give away this painting.
Uh-huh.
This painting to the people who love us and show up every day and are super sweet and wonderful. People like Mona and Kim Sim.
Okay.
And Hi Jinx and Langham and those people.
That seems reasonable, I guess.
So I'm going to be giving away the study, and how you would get that is all you've got to do is leave a comment after the show is over in the comments, and I use a random comment picker, and I'll notify you via your message system on YouTube. So you got to learn how to use that, your message system on YouTube, and we'll exchange emails and addresses, and I'll ship that to you.
So you're going to give away with this to one of our artists.
To one of our artists.
Okay.
And the contest will go till January 1st, 2016 is when I'll close it.
Well, I guess that's okay, since it's going to go to our community. But not the original. We're going to keep that. We're going to keep that for our collection. But
I've kind of ambushed John with this, so.
The study's okay. I think our community is going to like that.
I think that they will. And I think that that'll be wonderful to put that out into the world.
Yeah.
So what a good idea, Lindsay. Thank you. And I was a little bummed I couldn't enter because I figured it was like, you know, general contest, friends and family. But I was like, I also like pastel ballet dancers. That's what we're going to be doing today. We're going to be doing it in acrylic paint. This is a step-by-step, real-time art lesson. Which are, you know, these are popular around the country right now, and hopefully they'll be popular around the world. I'm going to show you every part of this process. So even if you're a very first-time painter, if you just had this crazy idea you think you might like to paint, and you got some paint for the holidays maybe as a gift, and you're like, what am I going to do with this? This is what you're going to do with this. So I'm going to show you all the steps and stages. How about we tell them the materials, which, as usual, I like to hide in the description. Also with more links to Lindsay.
Oh, yeah.
I always hide all that important information in the description below, materials and things. But we'll look at these materials and talk about them real fast.
What do you got over there?
I have burnt umber.
Oh.
It's a cousin of burnt sienna. It's also an ancient historic earth color. I also have Prussian blue. It's a little different than our friend Phthalo. Is that one okay? And today I have titanium white and raw. Unbleached titanium right here, quinacridone magenta, and then a little phthalo and a little cad, because we're going to make these little leaves and flowers, and isn't that going to be completely fun and wonderful? So this is just going to be this easy, relaxing, let it go, restore from the holiday craziness, restore from what's going on in your life. I imagine there's a lot of you going to be gifting this to some lucky little girl somewhere. So I know many of you have planned that. I'm excited about that. I'm going to dip my brush in water.
And we have a bunch of wishes for today.
That's right, wishes.
I can't let you forget.
So I'm just dipping my brush.
You're just getting excited.
I just got excited, but we do wishes on the show. What we like to do, and gosh, especially during the holidays.
We have a lot of wishes for today, too.
Yes. Wishes are important. You have to feel optimistic. You have to feel hopeful. And this weird thing a ton of artists do, they do it in art journaling, they do it in fine art, is they write words or meaningful sentences or ideas into their canvas, and they paint over it, and the idea is the wish is transformative and it makes you feel better. But here's what I'll tell you after years of doing this. It just makes you feel better.
It does. Makes me feel better.
It feels better. So we like to take some wishes from our community. and put them into the canvas. And we would encourage you at home to maybe put a wish on your canvas. Doesn't have to be a serious wish. It can be world peace, but it could also be just, I really wish the rabbits would stop eating my cabbages. That's a good wish. So whatever you need in your life.
Well, I'll start out. So Faith, let's see here. Mona and Janie had wished that both you and Faith get to feeling better because they know that you're a little under the weather. So they're wishing that you get to feeling better.
Just so you guys know, I'm using watercolor pencil to write in these wishes because the watercolor pencil will paint away. Whereas if you use graphite paper, a graphite pencil, like just a regular kid's pencil, you would be looking at the graphite seeping into the paint. Watercolor pencil, cheap, 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 from Michael's Artist Loft. And I know,
Okay, we got some more.
Okay.
So Connie wishes all those that have lost a loved one can find a peaceful place this holiday.
Yeah. And actually, there was a wish I read earlier in a comment where this lady had just gone through loss after loss after loss. Mm-hmm. So that I would definitely wish for strength and hopefulness through loss, because that's really hard to go through that, mm-hmm. especially over the holiday season. We will be with you guys Christmas Eve, so if you need somebody there, we'll be there painting.
Yep. We got a couple more if you want to get through this.
I do.
We have Sue and Spider, our own little Spider, have been wishing for no more bad dreams. They've been having some bad dreams.
Always, I feel so bad when they go through that. Sue?
Sue?
And Spider.
And our little Spider.
And our little Spider. He does not like bad dreams.
No.
He told me that this morning. I wish for you good dreams. Just so you know, I have a dream catcher planned on my calendar coming up this spring. Mm-hmm. So definitely come paint that, because it's going to be all about good dreams. And I want to say best dreams ever.
Oh, yeah.
Not only succession of bad dreams, but the best dreams ever for you. And we want that.
A couple little last happy dreams. We have a happy birthday for Patricia tomorrow.
Happy birthday to Patricia, and happy birthday to PJ.
Yeah. We're going to send
happy birthday, Patricia. How is Patricia a little brush, or is Patricia?
I think Patricia is a little brush in her heart for sure.
In her heart. So we're going to say that Patricia is 7 in her heart. I know I am.
I think that's a safe bet. We're going to. Oh my gosh. Mona just pointed out we have 101 people watching. So there's a wish for you.
Dude. In 100 wheel.
So
wish for me. Thank you, Lindsay.
we're gonna send a wish to Kim to have a beautiful wedding.
Oh, Kim, yes. We want you to just have the beautiful wedding, and I'm gonna wish for you great weather.
Mm-hmm. And we've got a flood of these. So the rest of the general wishes that are going out there for have a happy, blessed, and wonderful holiday season, and that's coming from Dusty, Mary, Sue, Yanni, let's see, Kim, Faith.
I just wish that for the whole world.
I mean, like, everyone is just sending that in.
Let's let the world just take a break from all its nice and nonsense and just have a happy, blessed holiday season. Just well-being around the planet would be wonderful.
I think that's some good wishing.
I think that's some very good wishing. I'm going to get my coffee because I'm needing it today. Mm-hmm. I'm a little nasally. I got a head cold going on. I don't usually get those. And I'm a big, big baby about it.
Well, that's okay. If you need to sneeze, you just let me know and
I'll let you know. We'll all know. We'll all know if I need to sneeze. And that's a scary thing for me. I've had 3 kids. Sneezes are not safe anymore. You know what I'm missing, sweetheart?
What are you missing?
What I'm always... Oh, there it is. Yeah, but I had actually hidden it over here.
I have something I can throw at you.
You have some you can throw at me? I like it when you throw things at me. It's super fun. So, if you didn't have burnt umber in Prussian blue, of course you could do this with your burnt sienna and your phthalo blue. It would just be a different kind of grayed out background. It wouldn't look the same as this, but would it still be pretty? Of course it would. The other thing, if you're really new to painting, what I would love for you to avoid is to mix entire plops of paint together. Besides being very, very expensive, you won't generally get the colors that you want.
And Do you think that in general we would need to put out that much paint?
I think you could be much more conservative with your paint. Like normally, I wouldn't even have any of the paint out but my Prussian Blue or my burnt, just because I wouldn't want it to be drying or gumming. I tend to put it out as I need it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But because, you know, I want you to know what the materials are, I just take one on the hip. I like this background. It reminds me of, you know, the romance background. So I just like this color scheme.
Mm-hmm.
You know, fun for me. When I want to show the little blue more, I might come pick a small smidge of white and work it into there. And that's the other reason why it's super good to work in incremental bits, not mix the plops of paint together.
Mm-hmm.
Besides, it saves you money. And it does save you money. And that's important to do.
Yeah.
You know, no matter what your painting budget is. I suppose the... Now, if you'll notice, as I'm painting with a 1-inch filbert. It's about 1 inch wide. It might be a little wider than that. The kids have got my ruler again, so I'll compare it to my thumbnail here. Now, this company, it's a 20. It's an ebony splendor. I know the hopeful wish is that these are all in millimeters, but unfortunately, some of the brush manufacturers don't play by sensible rules. We don't know why. Creative Mark does, so that would work, and they have nice brushes, but we've definitely seen some interesting variety of brush sizes. So it's always good just to get an eye line of sight so that you're not so committed to the number, especially if you're ordering online. I think that's where it's important to know that that can happen to you.
Mm-hmm.
If you're ordering brushes online, either you need to know the sizing of the brand that you're ordering or have a way to contact the brush company just to ask them how they are organizing their sizing. Because it would be very upsetting to think that you were getting a big, giant, hefty brush and then get a teeny tiny one, and then you spend a lot of money. You'd probably be pretty mad. Going, what is going on? It's a 20, and my 20 at home is quite large, and this is not. What's happening? That's what's happening.
Yeah, and I think that you have, like, a giant brush that's a 24, and this tiny brush that's a 24.
Yeah. And it's, again, I mean, most of them try to make some sense, but there's an art show that happens in China. I hope to go someday, an art material show that's 4 football fields.
Oh, yeah.
It's the biggest one in the world. And just paint manufacturers and paint products you've just never even imagined are out there. I'm hoping to go to the one in spring.
Mm-hmm. I hope we go to the one in Houston.
Yeah, the one this spring in Houston.
Yeah.
So excited to go to that.
Everyone's asking about your bracelet. They're like, she's painting with that bracelet. What is that?
Ooh, wait, I guess I do it here. Which one? Here?
Oh, we can see it there. Oh, it's all sparkly. See if you turn it.
I'm going to show off my mani, too.
Oh, yeah, they like that, too.
I love my mani.
Yeah, you got to wiggle them so because all the sparkle lights.
Yeah. It's sparkly. I like sparklies. So is Lindsay in the chat, John?
Oh, yeah, Lindsay's been out here.
She forgot to say
hi. I yes,
I figured she was.
Lindsay is here. I apologize. You know what? Sometimes I'm a really bad assistant moderator.
It is. Like, Lindsay's moderator, Sarah, probably totally feels for you because it is really hard to do that job and deal with anything. It's just crazy hard. The feed is fast.
Yeah, it really is. And, you know, I'm so accustomed to, you know, to seeing some of the friends out there that are just chatting away. That it's like I'm laughing over here at you know, at everyone's jokes. And, you know, Lindsay's in there chatting away. And I'm just, you know, having a good time over there, not even thinking about that. Oh, yeah, I should probably tell Cinnamon.
Yeah. Now, I'm sure if you're watching this now or into the far, far future of YouTube, you are a subscriber of Lindsay.
Yes.
I'm sure you are. But if for some crazy reason you are not, I really suggest you go over and check out her channel. She has, well, as of this point today, but who knows how many by the time you see it, 1,200 plus.
Yeah.
Incredible craft and art videos, and she does reviews, she does projects, she has really, I'm really impressed. I think one of the things that immediately caught my attention about Lindsay's channel when I was like first on YouTube was that she was doing this daily and she was still so inventive.
Oh yeah. Yeah, it's amazing.
That's hard to do.
Every day, something new and cool.
Yeah, and it is cool. Like, I'll see projects and I'm like, I don't really have any of those materials, but I would kind of do that for sure.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, thank you for grabbing that. Did you know we just spiked to 120 viewers?
We spiked to 120 viewers?
Look at that, yeah.
I'm going to dance.
Get your little dance on.
I'm going to dance now. You should give me a dance jam.
I should give you one. Do you want a dance jam?
I want a dance jam. Okay, I'm afraid of the content claim, but I want a dance jam.
I think we have some dance
jams. I'm just dancing without the jam. He doesn't even have the jam here.
Oh, I've got some in the background here. Just my...
They're
my,
just not... They're,
my, for some reason over there, iTunes decided to...
Have a moment.
Have a moment. So
that's probably okay. We don't get a content idea. Yeah. So definitely check out our channel. Just in general, beyond the ballet dancer, because there's something there that you want. If there's an art material you're thinking about buying, I cannot tell you how many times I have searched some art material, and Lindsay's tutorial was the one that pulled up. I'm like, I should just message her because I had a question about some chameleon pens. Whose tutorial pulled up? Number one. Lindsay's. I was like, I could have gone and asked a question before I even bought these things. Who knew? So it's probably there. It's worth searching. It's watercolors and it's pastels and it's acrylics and it's jewelry and it's clay and it's paper crafting and it's incredible. Like, I went to the dollar store and figured out how to make something you'd actually want to own. So, oh, that got a little light there and I don't want it that light. So I'll just put some dark paint back in, and I may darken this up later because we really want the dress to show on the background, so we don't want this to get too light. That's important. You may need to, as you're painting this, like say you bought some Liquitex Basics,
mm-hmm.
and they're perfectly fine paint. They're made by a big manufacturer. One good thing I'll say about purchasing Liquitex Basic line of paints is that this manufacturer cares that you are a customer.
Mm-hmm.
That is a very important thing to Liquitex. So if you were to, say, ask a question about a product or have a problem about a product, they will resolve it. My friend Maricha had some paint.
Maricha's in here somewhere.
Hi, Maricha. And she can tell you about it. Her caps had been broken in some crazy way.
Mm-hmm.
And they weren't like, ship it back and we'll see. They were like, just take a picture and we'll fix it.
Cool.
Take a picture and we'll fix it.
That's pretty good.
And I think I now she can correct me, but I think she got those paints at Tuesday morning or some crazy place.
Huh.
Right? And they were still going to fix it. So that is the one good thing. If you're going to buy student paint, it can be good to buy from a manufacturer that's international, that has a website, that has a help desk. And there's just a group of them. I think, you know, it's Grumbacher and Winsor Newton and Liquitex. And I think you could, I haven't tested the Artist Loft
mm-hmm.
to see if they have a help desk that is agile. Liquitex's help desk is fairly agile. It can take them a couple days to get back on a question. They're not like Golden, who's on you like flies.
They get you the answers, though.
They do get you the answers.
And you know it.
And you know it. They've answered your question. More than any question could ever be answered in the history of questions.
And we give them a hard time, but it's really good.
It is really good. We do
thorough.
Give them a hard time. It's so thorough.
it's awesome in the way that you celebrate, you know, people who celebrate a deep dive on something.
Yeah. We were saying that they reminded us of the company BMW.
Yeah.
A lot. Very similar kind of corporate culture.
Yeah.
I would say that Liquitex is more like Lexus.
Yeah. You know, it's I really liked that, you know, that they're, I mean, they know their stuff. They'll take the time to talk to you. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you kind of have to know your stuff to be able to talk to them.
Yeah.
So it's, I mean, that's,
but
the
I mean,
stuff.
If you need to know it right up to a conservancy level of paint information.
Yeah.
They are that deep because they work with conservators.
Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. I mean, it's like it's painty paint.
Yeah. They're just very serious, serious. Sars, papal.
Like
Sars.
Everything else is finger paints.
That is about their attitude. they're ripped Matisse.
They're kind of not. I mean, like, for what they make, I mean, I'm not saying they're wrong, but.
No.
I mean, so if you want to paint something that's going to be like a billion years in the most, like, and it is, like, if you when you take paint to a high art form, that's what you have.
That's what you have. But, you know, I mean. Again, and they're never going to make a Golden is never going to make a student paint.
And didn't they do something really cool with that, with an oil company too?
They saved a local oil company up there in New York, one of the handmade manufactured oils. And I can't remember the name. I'm going to guess that Miss Lindsay knows the name.
Yeah.
Because it's kind of up in her neck of the woods. Was closing and they had been friends. I'm kind of hitting a second coat wherever I feel like I need it real fast.
Sorry,
because
I
want this
you.
To be a rich finish canvas. So if you're seeing a lot of the strokes and brushes come through as it's drawing, which is just wherever it stops being shiny, you can come back and add another layer of paint.
Yeah.
But if it's wet, it may fight back on you a little bit. But that's how you tell if your paint's dry or wet, is you, it's not shiny anymore.
Well, it's looking really good.
Yeah,
it does. Everyone loves that background.
And honestly, I find this background really relaxing to do.
It is.
Everyone. It's just super chill, and I'm just painting this brown and blue happily along.
Mark thinks it looks a little tie-dyed.
Mark has been really... Mark, are you doing okay? Mark, is it Mark B or Mark Mark? Mark Mirror.
It's Zombie Mark.
Mark is, you know, he's one of our collaborators on the Doctor Who murder mystery. And I think he's feeling the pressure this week because he's been real punchy.
Oh.
In the fabulous, funny way that Mark is punchy. None of us are remotely upset. Don't start on Mark. He's good. He's good. We're all good with Mark. He's just funny. I'm just giving him grief because he needs it.
Yes, he does. He needs more glitter.
He definitely needs more glitter. Definitely more glitter. So it was a lot of fun being over on Lindsay's channel today, chatting with everyone.
Mm-hmm.
She gets a really international viewership too, which is really fun to see the people come in from all over the world. I know it seems like I've already done this and I'm still doing it, but again, this even here I am painting very high quality paint, but I'm still needing two coats to get this depth that I want. And I want this depth.
Yeah.
I want to be deep, meaningful.
Profound.
In my art. Profound.
Profound paint.
Profound paint. Because that's what our goal is as artists, to be profound. Beyond this is Colossus.
So Kim was asking.
Sorry.
What's the difference between raw sienna and burnt sienna? Hold on. Wait. No. Everyone was celebrating that we were at almost 130 people in here. So everyone was kind of celebrating, and it's going by so fast. Let's see. What is the difference between raw sienna and burnt umber for Alex? I guess Alex was asking that, and Kim was making sure I heard it.
Okay. Very cool. Thank you. That's a good question, Alex. So the sienna pigment, which is one of the historical pigments, I think these pigments are something like 40,000 years old on planet Earth for how we've used them. When it's heated, it deepens the color. So a raw sienna is the pigment unprocessed, just refined, just ground down into its polymer or oil, whatever the binder is on your paint. In watercolor, with the exception of core watercolors, it's mostly gum arabic. In acrylic paint, mostly it's polymers, and I'm just saying mostly now because it's like pretty much 99.9%, but there's always that weird company, like Acrylic Interactive or something. Mm-hmm. And then in oils, obviously, it's the linseed oil or those binders. So it is just the pigment out of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And then, honestly, if you get real drilled down into paint, you can, like wine, you can tell where your pigments came from.
Mm-hmm.
Ochres, particularly. We'll have a look depending on where they were sourced. And some ochres are considered better than other ochres. There's a lot of, you know, ochre hate. No, just kidding.
the ochre conundrum.
There really isn't, but it can, you know, to the degree you want to think about a thing in art, you can think about a thing in art.
Hmm. Yeah, you know? There's a lot of...
You know, that's more in your boutique brands of paint. That you worry about that, but that is what the difference is. So it's just a deeper, richer color that is created by heating the pigment. I left my fingerprint in there. I guess that's good for if somebody's looking at this hot mess later in history, going, why'd she do all this?
Because we were live.
Because glitter and live.
That's right.
There's so much glitter everywhere. Not because glitter is particularly evil. I don't buy that, Mark, but because
We're live.
And also my kids like to, they are very fond of the glitter and they get into it. And then once the kids have been in it, it definitely moves.
So when you're doing a varnish over these.
Yes.
Does it matter how long afterwards you varnish it?
Yes.
It does.
Yeah. Seriously. Here's the thing on varnish. Let me do this. Got a little belches. Am I back on?
Hold on.
I moved my mic.
Oh, yeah. I can hear you.
Okay. Varnish is easy and it's hard. I wish it was a different answer than this. I've got a video about varnish, but if you're not, you really want to read those manufacturer's instructions. If it says don't add water, don't add water. If it says do add water, do add water. If it says wait 4 to 5 hours, what they mean is wait 4 to 5 hours. A lot of times I'm like, I'll just see you in the morning painting. I will varnish you in the morning when you're completely cured and finished before I apply my varnish.
But what if it's like months later?
You want to varnish acrylic paintings sooner rather than later because the polymer molecules, they're kind of spongy and they attract dirt. And the dirt gets into the painting and the varnish is a sealant that prevents that from happening.
Gotcha. But
that's what you want.
But if you have, say, a painting that's been sitting around for months.
Yes.
It's okay?
I mean, if you read the Golden website, they want you to spit on a Q-tip and clean it. But I'm not kidding. They want you to lick your painting. But generally, yeah, if it doesn't have dust and you're okay with how it looks, you can absolutely clean it. You're not ever supposed to take a wet rag, according to conservators, and clean it down before you do something to it. But I have done that.
So one more real quick question before you.
But I'm not trying to put my artwork in the Louvre, and I don't really care about the guy 500 years from now who's trying to restore my painting, because I'm like, why are you trying to restore my painting, guy?
Well, it's a very good question. We'll leave a note for him to do a YouTube video.
I wasn't thinking about you. I was selfish and short-sighted. I didn't put an isolation coat down, and now you're just stuck with your Q-tip licking it.
So
sorry, that's what you do.
I believe you.
It's just so crazy.
So Joe was asking, he's never seen you use glazing medium or fluid.
No.
Does it have any real advantage over water for glazing?
Yes. I mean, that's the honest answer. And if it's in your budget, the word from on high is don't add water to your acrylic. Right? So they would want you to use an airbrush medium or another fluid medium that's designed to replace water.
Right.
Right? That if that's not in your budget, that's crazy. And if you're doing artwork as a hobbyist, acrylic paint takes up to a 30% mixture of water that it doesn't do what's called underbinding, which is their fancy way of saying the paint don't stick to the canvas.
Hmm.
Well, and it can flake off and it can do kinds of crazy stuff. It's actually tough to underbind paint, but it can happen. So if you were painting in a fine art practice, no, you would not use water, and you would use glazing mediums, and you would use mediums as your fluid.
Gotcha.
That is the actual answer.
Okay.
But for the purposes of what we're doing here, water's fine. It's going to last 100 years. You're good.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We should paint.
We should. I got to dry this.
Oh, do you? Okay. Yeah. I'll turn that down. Shoo. She's drying. So as soon as she gets back, we'll do more painting. Hey, you.
Hey. If you're painting inexpensive craft paints, hair drying, the heat from the hair dryer can increase the color shift of your paint, causing it to over darken. Just if you're like, you dry it and you're like, wait, that's a completely different color than what I painted. That is what happened to you there. On really fine paints, that will not happen as much. We're going to use chalk.
Are you?
Yes. Okay. Kids chalk.
Why are you doing that?
I'm just seeing on a chalkboard because it disappears into the paint.
Well, Anne Williamson from Periscope.
Hi, Anne.
She just. Hi. She's like,
how you doing, Anne? Pass the brush. Oh my goodness. So Anne is one of my collaborators on Periscope for Susan Hiles' once a month Pass the Brush event. There's a bunch of great girls on this, and we come out and do this crazy thing where we have 10 minutes to show you something, and then we pass the brush.
Which is crazy.
On Periscope. It is. It just makes John miserable because I'm like, oh my God. And then I, you know, we do it and it's over. It's just such a panic, but it's super fun and you see great stuff. And hi, Anne. Anne also has a YouTube channel. Click her little name.
Okay, so what are you doing?
I am going to make a mark in my upper thirds. So in art, they like to talk about the rule of thirds. Which basically is if there's a line and a line to bisecting your canvas in thirds here, and then another one here bisecting in thirds, an ideal focal point is here, 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 or here.
Okay.
Just helps you with design. Photographers use it, and when you see a good photograph, they're going to use golden proportions, they're going to use rule of thirds, and we do it here just because we can, and why shouldn't we? So I'm going to put a little mark right here, and this is going to let me know that I need something happening up here, and then I also want some gesture, some, you know, here's this dress flowing here. So I'm going to give myself a little chalk mark, which I can take up with water later, just to let me know I want sort of this flow here. Right? That's my gesture. That's the energy of my canvas because she's flowing. She's flowing through the, I'm sorry, I'm in a mood today. Now, this part of the drawing might be feel a little silly for some of our little brushes, but honestly, it's how you get them in. So those of you that want to laugh can laugh. I'm going to make a nice little sort of smile right at my thirds line. Right? And then I'm going to do, and I think we all remember this from grade school, the boobies. How you draw boobies. Do you guys remember drawing boobies?
No.
In grade school. Oh my gosh. Like you... He's acting like he didn't do that.
I know what you're talking about.
Totally, he did that. Okay, well, you know. And I'm going to come down, oh, just a couple inches and make a mark. I'm going to say, like, there's a little waist here.
Oh, you're...
Right? And I'm going to make a little inward curve. Right? And I might adjust that. Inward curve. I'm going to come down just under the bubby here. I make another little curve there. And that gives me a very nice bodice. And then I'm going to look at this and say to myself, is this taking up enough space on my canvas? Right? And I'm feeling like it could be a little bit bigger, so I'm going to make an adjustment. It's going to get a little bit like Hooters up in here.
Just have to adjust the bodice waistline too.
I'm going to adjust all of it. She's not Barbie. Right? And I'm going to, you know, I'm going to be like one of those LA doctors. I'm going to work it out. This is very strange. So what I'm looking for is I'm just looking for my line that I want. It's kind of fun to do, and I wholly suggest you do it. Now, I like that better because it's taking up more space on my canvas. And I really, really want it to do that.
I think everybody likes it, that they're bigger.
They're bigger. You're very funny, John. And then just to remind myself, for the gesture,
I meant everyone in channel. They agree. They want.
Yeah, they got to be bigger. They got to be bigger. Sometimes they need to be bigger, and you just handle it. I'm going to curve down like this. It goes out. It billows out a line. And then I'm going to let a line fall, flow up. And then you can kind of see the wind catch that dress. And that's really what it takes to do that. And then I know I'm going to want a little shoulder. I'm going to do some straps here. And I know I'm going to have some little straps. I'm not going to draw them all the way in because they're just really just painted in very, very lightly. And I've got that chalk there. Now you can, anywhere you want to erase it or, you know, make it calmer, you can just take, I've got a little tissue here. The crafters are big into their baby wipes. I have no idea what that does for the archivalness of paintings, but I imagine not enough to worry about.
But your saliva and a tissue is good.
Yes, if you were, I'm just never going to get over that article, ever. It's going to just get me forever and ever. I'm going to, because I want this dress to be very bright, I'm going to use clean water on this for sure. That's another tip. So I'm going to change up my water, And I'm going to get a small, nice filbert. Filbert being a surrounded brush. You could use a bright. You could use a round. It's whatever you can control easily. And this is also Ebony Splendor number 10. And I'm going to get my raw unbleached. I guess it's not raw. It's unbleached titanium. Here's the tube of it.
Now, there was a. I'll see. There was a question about unbleached titanium there that I saw scroll through in a moment. I'll see.
Probably,
if
you don't have unbleached titanium, how can you mix it?
Oh well.
I'm gonna guess.
We'll try that. Maybe one.
So, if you have raw sienna and titanium white, you can get a tint or tone that's very similar. If you don't, you could do, and you have our traditional Heart Party palette, you could add a little yellow ochre just to get an off-white or parchment color.
Hmm.
All right. So I'm going to, this is a very dry brush.
Catch your close-up camera there.
Yeah, I'm going to catch my close-up camera here.
You don't even, zoom in some more even.
Zoom is in. Zoom in on the bubbies.
Even more. All you're doing is paint those.
Huh?
Just, yeah, zoom in so we can see that dry
brush. I gotta show the waist, though.
Oh, okay.
All right. And I'm going to come here. And I'm even noticing I needed to open up my waist here just a little bit. I'm going to follow the implied line. And I'm going to not cover all my canvas. And I'm not going to paint down into this too deeply. I'm going to leave this sort of blue. And then I'm going to come up here on the shoulders, on the edge, the tip of my brush, like this. Flicking. I love to do the flicking. It's on the edge of the brush, my sharp edge. And I'm going to just flick a little shoulder strap that's light and airy, like tutus tend to be. Boy, they go like a couple of ways. Tutus tend to go like light and airy, or wow, that's some architecture. Where I'm like, so glad I'm not wearing it. And then to get the skirt, I'm going to just let it be a dry brush.
What size
I'm
brush?
I'm painting the canvas again.
Where are you going?
painting the camera again.
That's okay. That one's that old cannon's taken a beating.
So this is a number 10, filbert.
And about how wide is it?
Because, again, the kid's got my little ruler.
Go down to your this is the other camera.
So I'd say it's like just under a half inch.
Yeah.
And I'm going to keep flicking. And this part is really fun. You want the blue to show through. The blue showing through is what tells you that this fabric is very, very sheer. You don't want to take these strokes all the way to the edges. You want to leave this here. Because we're going to do our little squiggly happy lines. Right? And you don't need a ton of it here. This is just this under paint thing. That was super technical right there. Under paint thing?
Yep.
Super technical.
I caught that technical term. I'm going to put it in our thesaurus.
Under paint thing. Let me tell you, working at a studio as an assistant, you'll start referring to underpaintings as like that, too. You're like, this is an underpaint thing. Now, I'm going to put just a little of this paint, a little bit right here, and a little bit right here. But I'm leaving this dark right there. And then I'm going to have a sippy-sippy because I got to let this dry a little bit. Do we have any questions?
Oh, my God. There's a whole wall of questions that people are chatting about. But right now, none specifically directed at you, I would say.
Oh, well, you guys just have fun.
They are totally having fun.
Talk amongst yourselves. Talk amongst yourselves.
But what I'll say.
I don't know. It's terrible. What was I doing? I think I was trying to do church lady, but I'm just not Carrot Kari.
No. But we have 100. There's 135 people out there just chatting away right now. I think that they're all wishing Jane best wishes right now.
Jane, best wishes.
And where the heck she was.
Oh.
So, you know. Not that we're needed to be part of our community's conversation or anything. Sometimes I feel a little left out.
Do you? Now take a second and look at your dress and make sure that you've got nice flow. And I'm feeling like I need to carry some of this a little bit down just while I'm at it. I know mm-hmm. I need it to dry, but it's always good to step back and evaluate. What bothers you? Hmm? This is how you're training your artist eye anyways while you're at it, looking at your pieces. and making judgments. So I want there just to be a little more length right here. Okay.
Now that the feed's caught up, everyone's poking fun at me for lurking.
He's a lurker.
Because I'm chatting out there too.
His hat is really quite a thing to wear.
Where's the owl? Sarah would like to know where the owl mug is from.
Oh, the owl mug is from Kim. She sent me some heart mail, some love mail, which I really appreciated. It was like this big box of endless happy awesome. And the owl was in it, and I like it so much. Sorry. I guess I'm taunting. I don't know why. That's so weird, right?
I have your dance jam music ready for you.
Do you? I got my hair dryer. Okay, can we get hair dry and then we'll dance jam?
Okay. There she goes. And hello to all the Sherpettes that are in channel with us today. Thank you guys for joining us. Really appreciate it all. Man, there's 136 people out there right now. I can't believe everyone is out here hanging out with us. So thank you so much for coming by and chatting. Really appreciate you guys being in channel with us. It makes it a lot more fun for me to look out there and see you all here. You know, and, you know, to be able to talk about what you guys have on your mind with Cinnamon. You know, it helps me have something to do so I don't feel quite so, you know, alone out here with these headphones just listening to myself. Let's get Cinnamon back before I wander off. Jam? We can do dance jam before I start talking to myself and get too retro philosophical about it. You want dance jam?
Mm-hmm. I'm going to make sure I haven't messed up my mic. For Sippy Sippy. Dance jam. It's still not on.
Dance jam in there?
I do.
There
we go. Woo! Too much cold medicine. It's fine.
But you got your dancey in.
I got my dancey on.
You did.
I got my dancey dance on. Got my Marky Mark on. I don't know what I'm talking about.
I like this part of the song because it makes me think of ducks doing a little dance. I don't know why.
It's just fun. You should, though, if you are sitting for long. This is literally why, like, in art school, you have music on and you're there. The music is on, so every once in a while you remember to, like, I gotta move, because you'd be like this. You'd be like the Hunchback of Notre Dame all up in art school. So you gotta move around a little bit. It's actually a good idea.
Yeah.
Besides the fact that it creates more joy in your life, which is also good.
You should. And every opportunity to have a little more joy, you should take.
Now, I got a little titanium white onto my brush, and I've loaded it. And you can see how I've loaded it to the tip. I don't go all the way up
to the
heel here. I'm not to the ferrule. Right, another thing, notice when I'm holding my brush, I'm holding it here. I'm not holding it here. Don't hold it here.
Don't. Why not?
I want control over what I'm doing.
Oh.
That's just how I feel. Is there other answers to that question? Yes. But that's my answer. Huh. So. That's the thing that's hard for people to sort of wrap their head around in art, other artists, is that they sometimes get this mentality going, I'm doing the top of the dress here.
Zoom in. Zoom.
Because I'm going to be working a lot of it, but I'll zoom.
All right, there we go. They just like it when it's.
I like the zoom too. We worked hard to get a zoom. I'm gonna come around here.
I'm just gonna make you work for it.
And I'm gonna really work that shape. Yes, I am. Sometimes you want to work your shapes. I'm letting the white and the blue show through. Super fun stuff. Fun for me to do.
Well, everybody agrees that the dancing is important. And we had people chair dancing and
Excellent.
Table dancing and, you know, video dancing with us. So I'm pretty happy that we have some dance time. Dancy dance time.
Dancy dance time matters. Just breaking this up with loose brush strokes. I want to imply what's happening here without... This is a technique-based painting.
Mm-hmm.
right? Where it kind of, there's a lot in common in this painting with, say, a program like Donna Dewberry.
Yeah.
Where it's just about the brushstroke and about the design and not necessarily about the holistic whole art process. But what's wonderful about that is that you could take a painting like this and do it in a variety of colors and customize it. Once you understood the process or the technique, you could go to Design Seeds, which is a website about color, and pick their color palettes and make all kinds of crazy color combos of this.
Hmm. That'd be cool.
Yeah.
You know what people are now offering to Skype Dancy Dance in with us?
I would love that.
I think
that'd
be pretty awesome.
Is that possible?
I think it is.
Okay.
I think it's totally possible.
I'm ready for a Skype Dancy Dance in. I'm going to keep painting the dress while you're working at the Skype.
Oh, well, I mean, not right now. We're not going to do it probably today.
Oh, okay.
But I mean, like in the near future, we're going to do it. You know, so I just think that I just got to have it set up a little ahead of time and we can totally do that.
Yeah, I'd like to do that. All right, so now I'm going to come back and work this dress a little bit. So I'm going to come with my white.
I'm going to switch back over to our little more mellow music for a little bit.
Our mellow music? Are we relaxing? I'm telling you what, this dress is relaxing. And again, you can do this once you understand it needs a dark background so this light dress shows up. Or you could flip it and do a very light background and a dark dress.
Hmm.
Yeah. This is one of those paintings I like to say is an infinite number of paintings. For a little bit of my life, I had an art agent, and I worked in the commercial field.
Uh-huh.
And one of the things that you would look for is a piece that the color could be changed a little bit and tell a lot of different stories.
Hmm.
And so I think that's something that I definitely come back to on Heart Party here, is recognizing that those things still apply in this process. I always try to make sure that I utilize really good design.
Yeah. Now, Rhea had a question that was interesting.
I'm excited.
So she said, is it true that years ago they taught holding a brush at the end in art school?
Yes, probably. I've seen it.
You've seen it taught at some
yeah.
schools, yeah.
No, some people have some really strong feelings on this issue.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Hmm.
I kind of tend to go with, you know, you have instructors, you have people that come into your life.
Yep.
And so I had some people come into my, I had an instructor actually very specifically who came into my life. He was like all into yoga and kinesthesiology and all that physical stuff. And so she talked about a lot about working from your shoulder and how not to, you know, cause injury or harm to yourself while painting. And I think that I met her during a fundamental time, and that's where I picked up a lot of this. And my mom also does it this way.
Mm-hmm.
But again, the real truth of it is there isn't one answer in art. Like, whatever rule it is we think we have, somebody's going to figure out how to break it successfully because they're artists.
Yeah.
And that's what artists do.
But it's good to know the rules.
It's good to know the rules. But you can't get so attached to them that, you know, you don't see the opportunities for creativity.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to strengthen this right here at the waist.
That looking pretty cool.
Right? It just looks pretty cool.
Yeah.
I took that down stronger. So now I'm going to tell this little story here. Now I'm going to, you may want to switch to a detail brush. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do the tip of this filbert.
I'd like to give you a little celebration moment.
Are you?
We just had 152 people cross in.
Oh yeah, you got to give me a celebration moment. Put my brush in water.
You put your brush on. See, I'll go over here. I'll see if I can find some. We gotta find some. I don't know if I have anything. We gotta find. Where's it? Just you want the same dancey music?
I'm just like no, but I mean,
no, I don't have a whole lot. I have. You could. We could do this. We could do. Or we could do your music.
I don't know what's going on today. I'm in a very weird space. That's what I'll tell you.
And it's not the cold medicine, I promise.
No, because you live with me.
Yeah, this is just her. Although I have to say I'm an instigator here with the buttons.
I'm going to come tell a lovely little story. There's a term in art referred to a passage.
Uh-huh.
Right? A lot of times when we're dialoguing about art, we'll see an area of the painting we really like and we'll say, I like this passage.
Yep.
This stanza, this little bit here. So there's a passage that I like to create up here with these ribbons.
Mm-hmm.
I want a light brush. I just want them to flow up. There you go.
Have you rotate
just
your
tell
mic
that
up
little
bit.
Story there.
You rotate your mic up a little bit there for me.
So breathy today because the nose. How's this?
It looks good.
Okay. And then we're going to come down a little bit on the edge. And then here's what we're going to do. We're going to come here, and I'm going to imagine that there's this hem of this dress that's floating. And I'm just telling that story. Creating little passages. Tell the story of a multi-layered hem.
So
now, the trick is, I'm not making solid lines. Important trick.
Oh, yeah.
For success. What you don't paint, I'll tell you right now, what you don't paint, people don't criticize. If you let them, this is the brilliant of abstract art. If you let the viewer finish your painting, they will imagine you did it right.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I'm just saying, you let somebody come up and in their own mind finish it for you, they will imagine you did it right.
Yeah.
And they will leave you the heck alone.
So are you still using your filbert there?
I'm still using that same filbert because it has a really sharp edge. You could have used a detail.
Now, Lily, from one of the crafty twins there, she thinks that this is a really cute dress.
Thank you. Isn't it?
Lilia? L-I-L-A?
Lila.
Okay. I'm totally horrible about pronouncing names, so.
He does it too, his own kids. How are you doing?
Sorry.
You know, the crafty twins have a fantastic YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. And I actually sent them a Sherpa art collaboration challenge thing. They're going to make a video.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're going to come back with, they get to tell me what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll be letting you guys know about that when that's happening.
Yes.
Because I gave them something kind of crazy. So I'm super excited and pumped about it. Now I've got my quin over here.
Which one?
Quinacridone. If you only had a crimson, if you only had a cad, yes, of course you could use it. But we had just bought it because of Angela. Has Angela been here?
I may have seen Angela cruise through here earlier.
Well, we're all going to say Miss Angela made us buy quinacridone.
Now, is it quinacridone?
Maybe.
Or is
I don't
it
know.
Quinacridone?
Don't even start because I'm feeling good about it and then you started.
Or is it Passamaquoddy? Where are you at even? There you are.
And I have a head cold too. So I made it pink.
It's pink.
See my pink?
I know where pink is. Pink's there. No, it's a very painterly pink.
And I'm going to kiss this dress. Yeah, I didn't overmix it. That's a very good explanation. So if you look at this here, notice how there's dark pockets, light pockets, and then the mixture. And that's going to create what we like to call painterly.
Adjust your close-up camera.
Adjusting my close-up camera. Thank you.
See,
and as if this pink is a light that's reflecting on the dress, interestingly enough, I'm going to add some kisses of that. I want even more white in it. Right there. You don't want to get too crazy with it, but you definitely want it there. And then I'm going to add some of it to the skirt. I don't add any more pink to my brush. I just keep picking up white.
Mm-hmm.
Is how I get that done. Because this is a fairly potent color. I'm going to kiss it right here with some of that.
Just kiss with your...
Kiss
how
it.
How did you say that color?
Quinacridone.
Yeah. Apparently you're saying it right, so I'm going to have to mess you up.
Oh, stop. So I'm just adding a little of this pink. Just a little bit. Just to say that there's a little bit of this happening here. And I might come along this edge.
You have to zoom in a little bit more with that.
Yeah, there we go. Can you see all that little pink in there?
Yeah, we can. You zoom in.
Woohoo!
I'd like to see how they... All of the... There you go.
All right, so switch it over. And we'll take a tour on the close-up cam.
Yes, thank you.
Let's take a tour on the close-up cam.
Because see, here you get to see a lot more of the painterly, dry-brushed nature of this.
Taking a tour.
And you have a hard time picking that up.
Dude, this is really fun. Taking a tour.
Now, if you loosen
when you have the robot cam.
Loosen up the thumb wheel. It'll move smoother.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Whoa.
See?
I like this tour of the close-up cam. But now I can't tighten it up. You may want to save them before somebody throws up.
This is why we call this the nausea cam.
Woo! So, again, normally in painting, I would not have this much yellow out. Because I don't need very much. I'm just making a little green. I just wanted something that you could see and wouldn't dry out on me until I got here. And then I've got a little phthalo, and I've got my quinacridone, which John is messing with me. And I'm going to get a teeny tiny little bright detail brush. Let me see if this thing can see it.
Yep, it sees it. It's very...
And as an example of why you don't leave your brushes in water...
Yeah, you can't see there. You have to...
Okay, I'll do it. Where is it at? What is going on?
You keep stop moving.
So you can see how I have popped the sealant on my... If you don't get your brushes out of water and wash them, they pop like that. It's very bad. You shouldn't do it.
Yes, you leave them in there all the time.
I learned this from my mother. Shh. She'll say she doesn't, but she totally does. Like, totally.
So I'm pretty sure that that the Crafty Twins have taken over the keyboard over there. And they're commenting on your hat and right now.
Are they?
Yeah. So there's also a question.
I'm making a little green while we're at it with phthalo blue and cad yellow. I'm making a dark green.
So are we going to, is this going to be glittered?
No, this is not glittered. You could glitter one.
You could glitter it. Ooh, right. That's really blue and green.
Yeah. So, but I mean, it's still green and I've got it loaded up on the tip because I'm going to do a dab, dab, dab. And I'm going to start up here by over tighten that wheel. All right. And I'm going to go dab. Make a little garland that this designer, these ballet dress designers are really amazing.
Hey, I see Angela.
Hey, Angela.
I thought I saw her in here earlier. She's here and they're chatting there now. And I see Emmy. Emmy the Mastermind.
Hey, Emmy the Mastermind. Guess who's in here right now? The Crafty Twins. You guys should say hi to each other. They really should.
Yeah, they should.
All right. Okay. Emmy is a fabulous YouTuber as well.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm pushing buttons here. But, yes, absolutely. And you should definitely check out her channel.
Yeah. Check out the Crafty Twins. Check out Emmy the Mastermind. You got to check them out.
Yes.
You'd be missing out.
Let me see here. So people were asking about watercolors.
What would they like to know about watercolors?
Just if this could be done in watercolors. And other people were like, yes,
sure,
it could be done.
But, I mean, it would be done in a completely different way.
Yep. That seems
you know, you wouldn't want to, you wouldn't paint light over dark with this at all. And I don't know, definitely I would use some Friskit to hold my white. But yeah, you can do anything in any medium. It's just that the process of how you might get there is different.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It would probably be better in pastels. Because you could start with a dark ground and work this and then lighten, lighten, lighten. So I'm just adding these little implied leaves. just a little bit. Trick to this, should be thicker on the outside.
Oh, yeah?
And taper in.
Oh, yeah.
And now, me and my stuffy, stuffy nose are going to add some flowers to the dress. Because that's fun. And why not?
Because flowers.
Because flowers. I'm going to open this up.
Where you go?
Down where I'm working. Whoa! And I think I'm going to zoom out a little bit. Whoa, that's the wrong direction. You decided to spare them, huh?
Yeah. All right. So, Lou is asking if Arc Magenta can be a substitute for the unpronounceable color of doom.
So, here's the answer on all of it. All the reds are a replacement for the other reds. They're just, you know, are they cool? Are they warm? Are they going to make a hotter pink? Are they going to make closer to a peach? And then you just work with what your colors will do, and it will always be fine. Mm-hmm. It's not like, there's not a pass-fail grade like somebody, I mean, yes, in art school, if you use the wrong colors, they will get you. But in life, if I do this all the time. I don't have that red. I got crimson. I got nothing but crimson today.
Yeah.
I guess it's in crimson today.
That's.
And I just make adjustments for how I know the crimson will work for me. So you're still going to get a pinkish color for which you could kiss your dress, and you're still going to get flowers.
Similarly.
You could also do lavender here.
Yeah.
Again, this you can make work this out and make it your own. And I like things that you can make your own. I like to help everybody find ways that they can have a successful painting experience. But I also like being able to make it so that it's the kind of piece that you would be inspired to possibly shake it up a bit.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to come over here deeper into my yellow and add a little white to the mix.
Are you worried about staying on brand with paints here? Are you mixing them up? Does that matter?
Oh, yeah, I don't. Unless they're like golden open, which why would you be painting with golden open? And then even though they say golden open officially says that the opens work great with other acrylic, maybe golden heavy body, but not necessarily across all brands. Because my mom has a set and she's been working with them and they get gummy with the heavy bodies for her. And honestly, I'm going to take her word on that. If you were doing artist interactive paint, I would not mix those up. If there's a real specific kind of chemistry acrylic paint, don't mix them up. And there's some weird paint I'm going to go buy from Daniel, some weird French acrylic paint that he says like Cool Whip.
Yeah.
And he's not sure that should be mixed in to other acrylics. But in general, like if you're talking Golden Matisse and Liquitex, mix away. I mean, they're going to be mad at me, but mix away.
So, yeah, you're not
They just don't want you to know that you can just work those sales.
Right.
Work your sales. So if Phthalo Blue is on sale over on Golden and not on Liquitex, then I'm going to get it. But if Liquitex is on sale, I'm adding these light colors to the little leaves here.
Yeah.
If Liquitex is on sale, then that's what I'm taking home.
Since you're moving, you're fine.
I'm back down here, yeah. Thank you. So this is what we're doing. We're just adding a little of this lighter color, which is the bright yellow-green with some white. Super easy stuff. Just adding some little dabs of this. You know, and the only time that you will... Some companies, like Matisse, mixes a color that I like, and nobody else makes it. So I'm going to be buying my Australian Sienna and my Southern Ocean Blue from them forever. Watercolorists are their own kind of animal, and they'll have this... Lindsay's probably laughing wherever she is. They're their own animal, and they'll have a paint from a company that they like that's a color that they like, and they only buy that one. Take a couple workshops. I used to be a member of the Watercolor Society, and they'll be like, this paint from this brand, that's it, done, finished, done.
Mm.
If that paint company goes out, they just never have that color again.
So there were some questions about where should they... There's a lot of folks who are wanting to request paintings for the future, for the springtime.
Oh!
Where would they even start putting those requests in?
Definitely over. I read everything on the Facebook page. I can get behind the messages, but I try to read the posts. actually do read the post all because I'll try to like them so you guys know I'm like, it's all right. and people make suggestions over there, and I take that really seriously. Just anywhere you make a suggestion, mm-hmm. you know, if you tell John, he's just barely holding on back there. he's gonna have no idea, and then he's gonna be like, dragons, they want a dragon, sweetie, and then there we are in New Year's painting dragons again. But
well, they say dragons.
Well, I hope so, because they're gonna get one New Year's Eve, aren't they? And obviously, you know, I just like to hear what you guys want to paint. So definitely, this is about you. So if you have something you really, really, really want to paint, and then 50 of you say it, guess what's going on the calendar?
Yep.
Sometimes, though, also, one of you has an idea I just like, and that also goes on the calendar.
Yes.
Well, I'm going to take my quinacridone here, my magenta, and my white, and I'm going to have them. This is really, like, one of my mom's favorite techniques. I'm having it on the tip of the brush here.
Yep.
Unmixed. And I'm going to, yeah, okay, good. I'm making sure I'm on the right close-up. And I'm just going to dab some of that on there. Isn't that awesome?
Ooh.
I love that. Makes me so happy.
You could even zoom in on that a little more to see how that's.
Can it handle it?
Oh, yeah, I can handle it.
All right. So this is really at its heart an impasto, because I'm just taking very thick applications of paint and applying it, even though it doesn't seem so, but it's just the pure paint just dabbed on. Now if you add water to your acrylic paint, it can impact the impasto effect of your paint. It will flatten, which is why you might sometimes rather add a gel medium or some other medium rather than water, especially if you're doing like thick applications. Stuff we do, doesn't matter. All right, those little flowers are down there being themselves. Let's go up to the waist and bodice. Zoom out just a titch. It's so stuffy today. I need just a little bit, like a teeny tiny. I'm painting everything today. Sorry, babe.
No, it's okay.
No, I mean, I just hit the tripod over here. Just a smidge, right? Just a scotch. Rather than trying to put paint back into your tubes, as some artists do, I would really suggest that you just get better at putting out the amount you need.
So, Little Red was just asking a question about painting cats. And, you know, I'm going to say you can paint cats all you like. But, you know, I'd check with, you know.
What do you mean? What?
They just wanted to know if they could paint cats. And I'm like, yeah, you can go paint cats all you like. You know, you just got to be careful. You know.
Maybe they're making a suggestion for a theme, babe, because you just asked for a theme.
I've just been being silly. I made a bad joke and it didn't work out.
It didn't?
No, I was going to say it's...
Oh, like you should run and paint some cats. That seems like a thread banger kind of activity. Yeah, let's just challenge... Let's everyone just go challenge him to paint some cats.
Yeah, but that...
And then
yeah.
Corinne will be like, no, I opt out of that. And Rob will be like, all shredded and it'll be funny. Yeah. I'm not angry at them. I just think that would be really good YouTube.
But we could paint cats, though. We painted some big cats. We painted the lions.
We have kind of a cat, sort of this abstracty fire cat that we have on there.
Oh, that's right.
Then we have the glow cats. And then we have the lions. And there'll be more cats and dogs and things. Because I like those. Guess what, guys?
What?
We finished.
Oh, my gosh. We just wrapped that up.
We wrapped it up. We did it. We had so many people come by, and it is awesome. I hope you guys had a really good time. I had a really good time on my CRAFTmas Collab today. I love that we went for ballet, because you guys now have something to be working on into the new year. And, you know, no, what's more holiday than the Nutcracker?
What's that?
Ballet. I don't know. What is? I love, it's just like, I'm not going to sing it because they'll content claim me. But, I mean, it's that piece of music, right? So, yeah. Sugar Plum Fairies, dance in your head.
Yes, they do.
They do. And then I dance in your head, and then you wake up screaming.
So I want to say thank you to everyone who's come by, Lindsay and And I saw Audie, and I saw, who else who has been out here today with us? I saw Angela Anderson, and I saw Janie and Kim and the Crafty Twins, and Kim Emmy. And all of our moderators and
who moderated today?
Mona moderated, and Thank Kim you, Sim Mona. Moderated, and of course Mark Muir moderated.
Thank you,
and,
Mark.
Gosh, all the questions from the community.
Thank you, Mark.
Thanks, everybody.
So I hope I'm going to see you really soon. Where?
The easel.
Really soon.
Love you guys.
Love you. Thank you for coming.